performance by Arisika and art by Youth Spirit Artworks. The Sacred Stream Center is wheelchair accessible. For more information or to RSVP, call 510-540-1095.
This is listener-supported radio, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's time for About Health. All right, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Norton. Glad to have you back with me today. Glad to see we got some good weather out there. And one of the things about good weather this time of year, you know, that means that it's allergy time. And so those of you with allergies, you know, we've already talked about you're taking the proper precautions to take care of yourself, you know, do the things you know you need to do. Avoid the things you know you need to avoid. Take the medicines when you need them or whatever you choose as your option in management. And be careful. So a good thing that we have this kind of weather, but always this time of year, it's allergy season. And to an allergist, I don't know how to feel about that. You know, I'm glad. You know, on the one hand, I'm kind of glad to, you know, that that allergy season is here because I'm an allergist. On the other hand, I feel sorry for those of you who have it. So I'm kind of torn between this, but I think I'm going to make it. So today we have as our special guest Dr. Joy Del Perry. Dr. Perry's a physician administrator at the Career Multicultural Specialty Group in New Orleans. She has previously been the director of Women's and Children's Services at Jefferson Community Health Center and director of Clinical Services, City of New Orleans. Dr. Perry was responsible for four facilities providing health care for a number of different parts of the agency and continues to work to improve access and availability to New Orleans citizens post the Hurricane Katrina disaster of 2006, and we may talk to her a little bit about that. She received her bachelor's training from Princeton and Xavier, New Orleans, and her MD degree from LSU, and a residency in obstetrics and gynecology at Tulane School of Medicine. She's recognized as a fellow of the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology. She's won numerous awards from a variety of different places. Dr. Perry, we're pleased to have you. Thank you for taking the time to join us. Is Dr. Perry there? Hello?
Hello.
Oh, all right. Thank you for taking the time to join us. We appreciate that. So the very distinguished resume, very distinguished bio, and glad to have you here in a number of different capacities. We haven't had a program on women's health in a very long time. And so I thought that who should I talk to that I thought would make it easy for me and for our audience to understand those issues around women's health. And your name came to mind almost immediately. And we thank you for taking the time to join us. As always, this is a program for our listeners, so let me give you the numbers, 848-4425, the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Is our 800 number. We're KPFA, KPFB, KFCF in Fresno. Dr. Perry, tell us a little bit about your journey once you decided to be a physician into the area of obstetrics and gynecology.
Hey, well, thank you so much. I'm so honored to be on today. And Dr. Lenore, in the presence of such greatness, I'm excited even to be so far from New Orleans.
Oh, I see why you're so successful now. Go.
No, so I actually, my father's an ophthalmologist, so I've always been, you know, as they say, supposed to have been a doctor. But I didn't decide to do OBGYN until I actually became pregnant myself. And looking for a physician, I wanted a woman. And I saw there was a limited number of female OBGYNs. And, you know, I've never been one to understand opportunities. And so I thought, well, wow, if I can't find a female doctor, perhaps I should figure out what that looks like. And as I got more into medicine, I recognized that I love talking to women. I love all the things. Like, we love to, like, make up stories about how we got to where we are. And so the past year is only, like, 5 minutes. For 2 minutes. The rest of it is really listening to stories about their husbands and their kids. And so I call myself a pseudo-psychiatrist because all day long what I listen to is women and their lives and their stories and try to help them figure out a way to best navigate that.
Yeah, before we get too deeply into the issue of obstetrics and gynecology, give us a little synopsis and picture of what New Orleans is like now. Has it recovered and how is it different?
Oh, it's going to always be forever different. I've lived here, you know, for 40-some-odd years. And, you know, we are a city that's always changing. We've always been a different city. I guess everybody claims that, but I like to believe that we actually are a little different from a lot of other cities. When I go to places, I don't feel the same thing. Katrina was hard for us. I lived here. I was working at two different hospitals when the storm hit. 80% of the city flooded. Where I live didn't flood, so my home didn't flood, but the two hospitals where I worked flooded. And so I had to revamp myself. So I went from being a person who delivered 40 babies a month to a person who did more public health. That's the same thing that New Orleans has done. We reinvented ourselves. So although we're always going to have at our core, our base, is culture and music, jazz, and, you know, preserving kind of history and all those things, we're in flux. So we're learning how to do different things. So we're about 80% of the volume of people that we had pre-Katrina we have now. But they're not the same exact people. A lot of our folks live perhaps out in California or in, I have friends who've moved to all kinds of places, Utah, New York, Atlanta. And so people from those places have also come to New Orleans. So, 80% of the population is here. A lot of the homes are here, but we still have 20% that has not returned. And I don't know that they ever really will, honestly.
All right, let's talk a little bit about some issues in gynecology. And for those of you who are listening, Dr. Perry will be with us for a whole hour. And if you've got a question, and I don't want the men to go away from this program, because I know there are a lot of questions that you might have that need to be answered as well. So let's start with some of the controversies in OBGYN. One of the things that is probably most controversial, well, not controversial, but is this mammogram issue. I mean, there were some guidelines issued recently about mammograms, well, maybe last year, that were different from what we had thought previously. One of the biggest groups to object have been women of color because, obviously, they have higher rates of breast cancer, and we're very concerned. Tell us about where we were and what happened and where we are now.
Okay, great. So, when I was training, as if it was so long ago, but up until about 3 or 4 years ago, we always said at 35, you're the baseline, then at 40, you start doing either 1 year or every 2 year mammogram. I mean, then, you know, we start looking at cost in healthcare. I don't know if you've heard about that, Dr. Lenore, that all this change, where they want to see what things cost. And so the task force on preventative health looked at the cost and said, well, it wasn't cost effective to do it that way. So they came up with recommendations. The reality is the American College of OBGYN doesn't agree with those recommendations. Because our bases are not on cost. As a college, we have to look at what women need and kind of look at what's best for the community. And also as an African-American provider, we have to do the same thing. So we're already dying earlier from breast cancer. We're already getting treatments later. So to say, wait and get tested was just not an option for my patients and for my community. So that being said, the American College of OBGYN said, you know what, we'll stick to the 40. We won't go up to 50. So what we recommend is that you get a mammogram starting at age 40 every 1 to 2 years. And then you also, it's individual. What I love about medicine is not just this cookie-cutter idea. It's really an art. And so if you have risk factors or family members or any of those things, and you have a conversation with your provider about what's best for you, of course, you know, insurance company is still paying for you to have a mammogram at 40. And so don't wait till 50. If you're worried about it and you're 35, talk to your provider to see what that looks like for you. There's other mammography, not just regular x-ray, but digital mammography can see breast masses at a younger age. And when they were looking at it, the task force, they took into account kind of the risk of biopsy and the cost of biopsy, but loss of life. How do you measure that? How do you measure someone's life expectancy being shortened by waiting to 50? And so, you know, that is a hard question that hasn't really been answered. And so that's why the OBGYN Association said, well, let's just stay with 40 and let's do, you know, let's be individual about it. Let's let people have the opportunity to talk to their providers and really make sure that we are doing what's best for each individual patient and not kind of a global screening. You know, based upon what was cost-effective, let's move it up to 50. Even the American Cancer Society didn't move it up to 50. So really, I noticed in the media, it's been on The View. The day that it came out, I was doing a talk in a restaurant, and you know, every woman wants to know, well, do I not, you know, because it's painful to have a mammogram, and it, in general, you know, it's not something people look forward to, so you want to make sure that you're doing the right thing, that you're making the right choice for yourself. But what's more painful than anything else is having loss of life when you didn't have to. And so you really want to make sure that you, you know, get the screening when it's appropriate for you.
So. You know, money has been, a lot of interest has been focused on breast cancer for a number of years. Tell us a little bit about breast cancer. Certainly, I think the recent decisions made by Angelina Jolie to have breast removals, obviously, most people really don't understand that is that certain type of breast cancer under certain type of circumstances. We put a lot of money into the screening and the diagnosis and the management of breast cancer. How is breast cancer viewed now as opposed to when you first started in practice?
You know, the honesty, the reality is 1 in 7 women will have breast cancer. So I just really, you know, when I think about me and my friends, I have more than 7 friends. So although I don't have a close friend today who has breast cancer, the likelihood that I will before I die is very high. So it has a huge, it reaches a lot of people and a lot of lives. So that being said, can understand why it's really important for a lot of people, because it's not rare. It's one of the most common things that happens in our lives. We all know people who have had breast cancer. If it's not a relative or a friend, it's someone, a friend of a friend, and they're going through things, and it doesn't discriminate. As far as the Angelina Jolie in that world, you know, there is a genetic risk factor for breast cancer. And it's called the BRCA1. You know, I'm in New Orleans, so we have sirens going on outside. So the BRCA1 gene, if you have a genetic predisposition, it's really only 10 to 15% of breast cancer. So 85% of people have breast cancer, there was no genetic predisposition. So if you perceive, because you don't have a mother or a grandmother with breast cancer, that means you're safe, that is the wrong perception. Really, that is the rarity, you know. It's just that when you have the genetic predisposition and you do the genetic testing, as Angelina did, then you have to make some choices around that. So it's really controversial even in doing the genetics. So she did the test and it came back positive, and so she decided to be proactive. She didn't want to wait to get breast cancer because she knew she had a high chance of getting it. She went ahead and had her breast removed so that she didn't have to worry about that. Not everybody has that option. Not everybody knows that they have this genetic. If you know that your mother or your grandmother or your aunt had breast cancer, you go talk to your provider about getting genetic testing. But there's a chance it was just random. You know, like I said, 1 in 7 women, 1 in 8 women have breast cancer, but if it's not random, you want to know that. You want to talk to them about it. You want to talk about your family history. In our communities, a lot of times, we don't talk about kind of our histories, and we don't let people know what we died from. We know they died from cancer. We don't know what kind. So it's really important that you really get a clear picture of what the source was so that you can discuss that with your provider and make an informed choice about getting tested going forward.
Now, do you think we're making progress on the management of breast cancer? Okay, well, I guess that's good enough. We're talking with Dr. Joy Crip-Perry. She's an obstetrician gynecologist. She'll be with us for this hour. Now, if you've got an issue around obstetrics or gynecology, this is what we call, Dr. Perry, the least expensive, not the cheapest, second opinion in town. And so we want our audience to join us. It's 1-800-958-9008 is our 800 number, 848-4425 is our local number here in the San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley area. And this is a chance for you to talk directly to an obstetrician and gynecologist about the things that you're concerned about. So 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. I told Dr. Perry to be prepared to work this hour, so don't let us down. All right, let's go there first to Elaine in Oakland. You're on About Health. Elaine? I can't hear. Is Elaine on the line? I think Elaine called on another line, so maybe we should pick that line up. Elaine, is that you?
Hi, I just got disconnected.
Uh-oh.
He called my name.
All right. What question do you have for our doctor?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's you. Okay. You know, I'm past 60, and I have never had a mammogram. And the reason why is because there's so many things written from the holistic point of view, alternative that it can actually put radiation into our body. And so I've had, this other procedure. It's not a telegram.
No, it's not a telegram. No. I can guarantee you that.
Mammography. And so I just wondered what her thoughts were about that, and I can take my answer off the air.
Okay, no. So I guess I learned long ago not to try to make people do much of anything, honestly. I mean, part of it is your comfort level. So for us, I cannot say that there is anything that is better than getting screened before you feel an actual mass. Maybe you had an MRI, but you mentioned having a segmental mammogram, which is what a mammography is. I don't think that's necessarily. Do you remember the name of what it was that you had done before?
All I can remember is that they called it a thermography.
Okay, right. Yeah. So the purpose of a mammogram is to pick up a mass before you can feel it. Okay. And
yeah.
So done lots of studies around kind of the exposure. It's an X-ray, so it's just like anything else. If you had, you'd have to have a lot of X-ray. We have pregnant women who get X-rays, and they don't have, you know, any kind of malformations in the baby or the fetus or any of those things. However, if you perceive that you're going to have sometimes the stress of whatever the situation is greater than anything else. And so although I advocate for getting mammography and getting it done early, I don't want you to do something and then feel worse about what you've done than getting it done in the first place. So, if you, there's evidence around doing self-breast exams, feeling for masses your own self.
Yeah.
There's also evidence around having, other non-X-ray inducing exams done. And so if that works for you, that's fine. Just know that, for us, the standard of care is to have mammography starting at our age 40, because the goal is to see it before you can actually feel it. And I don't know any other form of technique that can identify breast cancer before you can actually feel it. And so I wouldn't advocate not doing what we recommend. However, I also advocate that people should do what they feel comfortable with doing.
All right, thank you very much for that. All right, 848-442-5180-958-9008. Our guest, Dr. Joey Creperi, our topic, obstetrics and gynecology. Let's go to Portia. Now, you're on About Health.
I had breast cancer in my late 30s and had treatment and mastectomy and so forth. That's been almost 14 years ago, so I'm in my early.
Hey, congratulations.
Yeah, it was a grueling experience. With the remaining breasts, would you recommend having a mammogram done every year? And just a side note, they really weren't able to pick it up
right.
When I was in my late 30s and was much more advanced by the time.
And unfortunately, the way mammograms work, imagine that it's an X-ray, so it needs your breast to be less dense. And I don't know if you remember your breast from your late 30s now. They look a little different, probably.
Mm-hmm.
So the breast you have remaining, the remaining breast tissue, so as you get older, your breast tissue thins.
Nope.
Mammogram doesn't work really well in your 30s.
Okay.
It's not very effective.
Okay.
And so as you can see it when you're looking at your breast structurally, anyway, like I have friends in their 20s and they want their breast to look the exact same way at 20 as it does when you're 60. That's not the way that our breasts, they change.
Yeah, the way
the mammogram, yeah.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. So the remaining breast you have is different structurally, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was, yes. And so the mammogram would probably pick it up better now. What is do you still see the oncologist?
No.
You saw before?
No.
Okay. Do you have a primary care provider that does breast exams?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. So doing a breast exam picks up 80% of lesions, but that's when you can feel it.
Right.
So the benefit of an actual, so you don't want it to be wait till it's late stage.
Right.
The goal is to pick it up earlier. So the benefit of a mammogram, especially over 60, is that you can actually see the changes on an X-ray that you couldn't see in your 30s because of that breast tissue is less dense.
Oh, okay.
So you got it? Yeah. So the goal, so now, although it didn't pick it up before, it's not the same now that it was then.
Hmm.
And so the goal is really to have you have a longer, more productive life. Right. And I know sometimes it doesn't feel like that's what doctors are doing, but really that is our goal.
Okay.
So, you know, I think if you went back, you know, if you talk to your primary care or you talk to the oncologist and say, you know, I had it in one breast, whatever, you know, there's a chance you will have it in the other breast. It's not there's no guarantee that you will.
Right.
But being vigilant about checking the other breast, you know, and knowing that now between the MRI and maybe the mammogram and maybe digital mammography will pick it up earlier so that you don't have to have the same, as much of a procedure as you had before in your late 30s that you have, would have to have now if something happened.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that call.
Good. Thank you.
All right. We're not through with any particular topic, but I do want to introduce the topic of menopause, because menopause seems to be, in many instances, a controversial period. There are a lot of myths about menopause. There are a lot of myths about what it happens, what causes it, but what the outcomes are from menopause. And so many people, tell us a little bit about menopause. What are some of the common symptoms that it starts, and some of the things that you've heard is myths about what menopause actually results in.
Okay. So, first of all, I really despise the term menopause, but it's just the way it was, you know, I'm a language person, and so I would like for there to be another term, but since that's all we're stuck with, we'll stick with that. So, technically, what menopause means as a gynecologist is you have 12 months with no period or no menses. So, if you started January 1 and you didn't have a period, so January 1 of next year, you are technically in what we term to be menopause. There's a period around which that you have what we call perimenopause, where your periods start slowing up or they change in their frequency. So on average, the average woman reaches menopause at age 51. You know, none of our patients read a textbook. They never say, oh, I'm going to do what you tell. 51 is average. So that means some people are in their 40s, some people are in their 60s. Everybody, we're all individuals, it's all based upon genetic factors, dietary factors, cultural factors, all that stuff. So the most common symptoms, the first most common symptom is hot flashes. And so, you know, about 75% of women have hot flashes. And what we define as a hot flash is a sudden feeling of hotness, of warmth, that usually starts from kind of the lower parts of your body and goes up to your head, to the top of your head. You'll have profuse sweating. You might turn red. And then, you know, it goes away. They're usually intermittent. The thing about menopause and hot flashes, none of these things will kill you, right? So they're not life-threatening, but they are life-altering. You know, if you've just recently gone to get, you know, you have a nice outfit and you're fully made up and you're going somewhere and suddenly you start sweating profusely, that's not a nice thing to happen. You know, you're feeling good and looking cute and have makeup on and your hair done, and then suddenly it's all messed up. So we're just starting to realize the importance of, although something might not be life-threatening, having something be life-altering is still important. And how do we then manage kind of the symptoms of menopause those things.
Well, let me ask you, you know, when we do programs on women's health and we talk about menopause, many, many women call in and say that it probably doesn't need to be managed. I mean, and if it is managed, there are all kinds of non-traditional, cultural ways in which to deal with. Does menopause really need to be managed?
Right. It really is such a personal choice. I always give people this example, right? When I started practicing, they started off with this idea that the medicines that we were given for menopause were bad. So the hormone treatments were bad. And so my mother, at the time, her doctor took her immediately off of her estrogens and everything else. And so 3 days later, when she was sweating profusely, she called me up and said, I don't care what they say on TV. I want my medicine. You can call me in a script. So that's a very personal choice. Some women can manage it and say, you know what, I don't mind getting hot and sweating. I really don't want the side effects to come with these medications. I'm not interested in the side effects of some of these medications. I would like to just kind of live and be natural, or take, ginger, or use some of the over-the-counter, you know, medicines that you can get from like a herbal store. Some women just don't, you know, they don't want to take any kind of medications for it. Because it's, you know, like I said earlier, you're not going to die from menopause. However, some women, for them, it's debilitating, and they can't sleep. They're having difficulties in their relationship. They have mood swings. They have vaginal dryness. And they would like an option. And so to make one choice based upon one person is not fair. And so to have an option to say, if I want to take medication, I can. If I don't, I don't have to. That's the freedom of being a woman in this space. You get to choose what fits you best.
All right. Martin, we had a caller named Mark who thought we were changing the subject. So I'm inviting him to call back when he has an opportunity. But in the meantime, let's talk to Karen in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Oh, good afternoon, Dr. Lenore and Dr. Perry. It's a very interesting topic. So I'm almost 70. I've never had a mammogram. And then when I was about 30, I did have some lumps in my breast, and I went and had them examined by a gynecologist, by my regular doctor, and my yoga teacher, and they all told me that they were actually engorged mammary glands, which is very typical, and that they weren't like a hard lump, but they had the potential to become something other than just an engorged mammary gland. And they questioned me about my diet and my exercise regime and what I was doing, and I quit drinking coffee to their recommendation. I've been drinking a lot of espresso, and they said to start walking every day, at least a half an hour every day, because in the heel of the foot there is a little valve, and when you walk, that valve opens up and starts pumping and dumping waste matter from the lymphatic system into the excretory system, you know, when you sweat and when you do that. So that really got me going. As I said, I'm almost 70. That got me going on an exercise regime that I still to this day, and within 3 months of their physical exam, I didn't have anybody, you know, poking me or lumpectomy or anything like that. Within 3 months of that, those lumps were gone, and they have never recurred. And so I think that was a really great, you know, suggestion for me and information, and it worked for me. Everybody is different. And when I did go through menopause, when I was about 50, I had one hot flash for 10 years. I was always hot, always warm, didn't have a problem sleeping, but it was not like I had a flash and then that was it. And I did not take any, you know, estrogens or, you know, hormone replacement or anything. I did, you know, wild yam root, and I used all those kinds of things and just kind of got through it. So I wanted to just put that out. And as you said, and I agree, everybody's different. Everybody has different reactions to it. But that was really, I feel really grateful that I got the information that I did.
All right. Well, thank you very much for sharing. Any comments, doctor?
No, I just want to say that really, having lumps in your breast is really part of the reason that the task force kind of de-emphasized having mammograms, because so many women have lumps in their breasts. And so many women have lumpectomies or biopsies, and so really trying to have a balance between having actual lumps from engorgement or enlarged glands or, you know, lack of exercise or diet or any of those things, and seeing what's an actual cancer. That's a hard call. There's no easy answer for that.
Our special guest, Dr. Joy Carrier-Perry, she's an obstetrician and gynecologist based in New Orleans, very experienced in the issues of women's health. If you want to join us, 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. There's several things on my list left over from my last conversation, things about fibroids, things about family planning in terms of having more children. Where are we with that? A number of different issues have come up through the last weeks, and it's been a while. So if you want to join us, talk about obstetrical issues, talk about gynecologic issues, share some of your own stories or share some of your own information, don't hesitate to call us, 848-4425 and the 510 area code 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Revy in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hey, hi. Can you hear me?
We can.
Okay. I'm taking us back to the mammogram question. Sorry to be backtracking here. But I am 42, and I am breastfeeding. I have been breastfeeding since I was, I had my baby 6 weeks before my 40th birthday. And my OBGYN has recommended that I do not have a mammogram until I am done breastfeeding. And I would love to know if your guest agrees with that.
Ow!
And so, you know, because of the controversies around when we start mammograms, mm-hmm. It kind of positions a leeway to say, let's individualize it. So you're a perfect case for being individual. So you're still breastfeeding. And so your breasts are then engorged with breast milk, and the right. glands are engorged. And so the actual the test won't be very accurate. We had a caller earlier talking about how when she was in her 30s, the mammogram didn't pick it up. So, you know, you want to make sure that we maximize. You don't want to go through a procedure that doesn't maximize the benefit for you.
Right.
You want to make sure that you're doing what's best for you. And so while you're breastfeeding, it's probably not the best time to have that done. And it's important that your child get the breast milk and all the advantages of that. And so, you know, breastfeeding until you're finished is a good option for you, especially if you're comfortable with that.
Okay. And even if I continue to breastfeed for another 2 years, you would still recommend yes. that I just hold on.
So to be really honest, the controversy around mammogram is that there's a group that says you should wait till you're 50 anyway, based
right.
on money
right.
and all the other stuff. And so saying to you at 42 to wait to 44 is still younger than what they say you should do for a mammogram anyway.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
I really appreciate your advice. Thank you.
No problem.
You know, one of the issues that often that we've had callers about has to do with and let me just say this: as I change the subject, those of you who've called on the previous subject, please stay on the line. I'm just trying to get a little more information and to try to catch up on some of the questions I've had through the weeks. The whole issue around endometriosis, I mean, that seems to
yes.
be something that rises and falls, and that people don't appreciate, that gets diagnosed late because it's not thought about. Tell us a little
right.
bit about what that is and exactly how you make that kind of diagnosis.
You know, and the thing about it, the hard part of an endometriosis is it's a clinical diagnosis usually, which as a provider, what that means is...
Could you tell them?
Could
you just tell them what it is?
Yeah, so normally, because when we say clinical diagnosis, what that means to us...
Let's go back to the... I should have asked you what the endometriosis means.
So, right. Yeah, so endometriosis technically means that instead of having... You know, this is the common way to understand what it is. So every month, your cycle comes out of your vagina. And so imagine that some of the cells that would come out of your vagina, so instead of them coming out of your vagina, they go into your abdomen. They go back up through your uterus, through your tubes, and into your abdomen, and they implant on your ovaries or on your tubes or on your abdominal wall. And so it's a fluid system. So when your uterus sheds, lining, instead of all of it going one direction down and out through your vagina, some of it goes back up out through your tubes into your abdomen. And so because in order for us to really see that happens, we have to do surgery. We have to look inside your abdomen and see endometriosis. A lot of times we don't know that you have it until we actually do surgery. So we have to go by your symptoms to say you have pain or you have things happen around your cycle. And we assume that means that you actually, instead of all of it coming out of your vagina, some of it is going into your abdomen. Is that what you're
No, yeah. So you, and so what do you do about it? How do you make the diagnosis? Have you been able to narrow the gap between the time these symptoms develop and the time the diagnosis is made?
You know, it's a really hard one because you don't want to do surgery on every person that has pain. And so when someone comes with pain with their cycle, is it just that they have cramps? Differentiated between, you know, you try medications to see if that'll make the pain go away. You know, you try doing, between nonsteroids, which is like Advil or Motrin. Try doing things like having them to change your diet to have decreased, taking less fat in, to do more vegetables, to do more exercise. Exercise definitely helps with pain during your cycle. And if none of those things work, then you're stuck with, okay, well, maybe I need to look and see if there's something bigger. And so in the meantime, though, you might have had this kind of symptom going on for a long time. So what we do to diagnose it definitively is we do what's called laparoscopy, where we put a scope in through your belly button, and we see if we see actual pieces of endometrium or little black spots inside your abdomen around the time of your cycle, and that would be endometriosis, and we take biopsies and send it to the lab. I can say that it's hard to do. I mean, people have pain and they never we never ever get that diagnosis. Of, you know, there's risk of surgery. You get put to sleep and you get a risk from anesthesia. So you don't want to take it lightly to say, I need to have the surgery done to see if I'm having endometriosis. Really kind of, for us, something that we want to make sure we've exhausted trying non-invasive procedures, because there's risk for procedures on your body.
All right, well, let's go to Akeisha in, well, I guess Akeisha is somewhere, but Akeisha, somewhere. But let's, before we do that, Akeisha, hang right there. Let me say we have several more minutes left in our program. We're going to get to some issues around HPV, some issues around sexual problems in women. So if you've got questions, I mean, here again, this will save your copayment. This will save you a visit to the doctor. So 848-4425 and the 510 area code 1-800-958-9008. Dr. Joy Creperi, a very experienced gynecologist from the city of New Orleans, is our guest. And so if you want to join us, this would be a good time. All right, I'm sorry, Keisha, it's your turn.
Oh, thanks. Glad to have this heard by someone. Okay, so I've been having a history of anemia as early as I can remember being a child. And later on, I had a fibroid tumor removed in 2012. And I had all the symptoms that go along with that, the outrageous period and the extreme exhaustion and all that. I actually have a normal period now, but... absolutely. But some of the symptoms haven't gone away, like the exhaustion, the extreme sweating. And now, instead of anemia, I was actually diagnosed with pancytopenia. And I was wondering, I'm trying to wrap my brain around what that is, and are they linked?
Right. Okay, so let's take one thing at a time. So 70 to 80% of black women have fibroids. So the chance that you had a fibroid and was causing you to have bleeding and crazy periods was really, really high, right? Like, everybody I know, you know, most of my patients, including me, we all have fibroids. And so having a fibroid removed usually treats those symptoms of heavy periods, heavy bleeding, and pain. And if the anemia is just because of that, it's because you have a period. So a lot of times we don't know that our periods are heavy, and it's always been heavy. So to say something is heavy requires you to have a frame of reference of it being light. You don't know that other people only have a period for 2 days. And you think it's normal to go 8-10 days and have to do all these things because that's what you perceive to be normal. So yay for you that having the procedure fixed that part. Now, saying that you have had anemia since you were a child, you did not have fibroids when you were a child. And so that's a separate issue, I would assume. And so having a pancytopenia is probably more linked to the fact you've had anemia since you were a child than the fibroid. The fibroid in and of itself is a muscle tumor, and it causes your period to be heavy because it's like your uterus is the size of your fist normally, and it has blood vessels that go through it, and every month you normally have a period. And so most people, it lasts about 3 days, maybe four. If you have a fibroid, instead of just having something the size of your fist, it can be the size of someone who's 5 or 6 or 8 months pregnant. So all of that engorgement, all that muscle, bleeds. It causes shedding. It causes pain. And so that'll make you have anemia and pain and all that. So removing that will cause improvement of your symptoms in general. But if you have another reason on top of that, and it could be anything, it could be that you have a blood dysphagia. So you can have sickle cell is the most common thing. Sickle doesn't cause sickle cell anemia. It's like the thing that people see in the news, see in the media. Okay. There's a lot of other blood disorders or blood illnesses that are not, they're not cancer. They're kind of genetically, they're usually in either Africans or African Americans or people from Mediterranean descent, and it makes them have differences in their blood. It could be something like that. It could be a lot of different other reasons, but it's not related to the actual fibroid. How could I?
All right. Well, thank you very much, Akeisha. Let's go to Diane in Petaluma. You're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Lenore.
Hey, Diane.
Hi, Ann. yes, doctor, I had an ovarian, an oophorectomy, bilateral oophorectomy, and a vaginal hysterectomy in 1993 in South Lake Tahoe. And it, It was a very big mistake, and I'm still suffering from it. But I was, even though I'm a registered nurse, I was scared by the questions he asked, such as, well, you could be the second coming of Gilda Radner, things like that, and we know more questions than we have answers, and my... I think it was a CA-125 was elevated a little bit. But anyhow, so I agreed to, at the time, a vag hyster with the possibility of having my ovaries removed if there was cancer. And we never did any tests before that except for a sonogram, as I recall. And so we went ahead, and everything was hunky-dory for about 2 weeks after the surgery. And then I became extremely depressed and was crying all the time. And they put me on Zoloft and Xanax, which was disastrous. I was, anyhow. So the problem was that it came down to I didn't have any cancer anywhere, and it was just a fibroid that was causing the pain that was wrapped around a ligament in my stomach.
Right.
So I am still depressed to this day, and I have major depression. I've been to therapy constantly, and I've been taking every medication under the sun, and I've had my hormones tested, and it doesn't really seem to be anything wrong in that regard that should require hormone replacement. So I don't know what's going on, but I still also have extreme hot flashes. I never went away.
Right. Okay, so the reality is that hysterectomy is the second most common surgery in the U.S. So if you really absorb what that means, we do a lot of hysterectomy. Appendectomies and hysterectomies, and, you know, I could talk again about the language around why we call it hysterical. Women are hysterical. We need to remove their uteruses and all that. So I'm a feminist at heart. But anyway, so you had the surgery done a long time ago for the indication that they were worried about cancer, and you had no cancer. At the same time, you had pain. Half the women.
Yeah, on the left side, yes.
Yeah, so half the women who have hysterectomy before pain have increased pain afterwards. And so going back to what happened, you know, in the 90s to now, a lot of it hasn't honestly changed around women still having hysterectomies to relieve a problem that really isn't their issue. If it is that you're having problems with pain or with depression, you know, our bodies, our physical bodies are not separate from our mental state. They're one and the same, and we spend a lot of energy trying to make it be, if I could just, you know, it's like people who have chronic headaches or chronic low back pain or chronic, you know, for gynecologists, it's chronic pelvic pain. Those issues cannot be treated with just one simple thing. They take a lot of multidisciplinary approach, you know, using your gynecologist that can listen to you about what's going on with your, because you still are a woman and you still have, you know, although you don't have a uterus or ovaries anymore, you still have hormones that are absorbed inside of your fatty tissue. So when they check your hormone levels, they're checking to see that you still have estrogen because it's stored inside of your body. So it might be normal, but you still have the symptoms of someone who doesn't have some of those organs. And so then also working with a mental health provider, work with your depression, to make sure that all those things come together. Physical therapy and all those things are really important. So there's not just one answer to make that be whole, really a multidisciplinary answer to make that be whole.
Well, I've been trying everything, all of those. I've been a nurse for 34 years, and I've tried to make them come together in some way, but it doesn't seem to have happened that whether it's just a matter of psychological depression or a matter of my consciousness or how I think about it, or a matter of just of the hormone replacement, because my depression seemed to have started, like, as I said, like just 2 weeks after my surgery, and so I kind of associate it with, my surgery.
Right.
I was out of work for 18 months after the surgeries. But none of the medication and no, I've been in therapy with both psychologists and a psychiatrist. And, of course, psychiatrists these days just order medications for you, basically. But I've been with psychologists also, and nothing seems to help. I've still... just lately, I just stopped taking my antidepressants, period, because I'm having trouble with my cogitation at this point, and I don't want to keep taking them. I'm just going on a trial of stopping taking them, period, and seeing what happens.
Yeah, that sounds like something that you should. That's a proactive step that a lot of people take. So thank you for sharing that with us, Diane. I'm sure you're not the only one out there who's having a similar problem, and your willingness to share, I think, can maybe motivate someone else to call or gave them some answers. One of the things, Dr. Perry, that you mentioned when I asked some of the issues that were interesting to you, you talked about, you said we can't have to talk to a gynecologist without talking about sex. And when I first looked at that question, I said, well, why? And then I realized, well, where else are women going to talk about sex? And certainly not with men. So I said, tell us a little bit about the role of the gynecologist in sexual problems.
Yeah, the funny thing is that I didn't realize that, honestly, until I went into practice. You don't think about it because you don't really talk about sex. And, not many women are people go to a therapist. And so whereas men can go to their primary care doctor and get Viagra or get a medication to help with whatever's going on with their libido, women, we don't really have a space for that. So I would say half of our practice is talking about relationships and sex and issues around sex, anorgasmia, pain with sex, dryness, lack of interest in sex. And because America is such a, we want a pill and a fix it or a surgery and a fix it, people come in every day and they ask, can't you just give me some Viagra? Or can't you just fix, I don't want to have sex with my husband, fix me. And it's never that simple when it comes to women. Like we are, we're much more complex. You know that, right?
I just sit back in wonderment and just keep rolling. But go ahead.
So it's not that simple. There's no pill. There's no surgery. I can't make you magically want to have sex or sex not be painful. We know sex for women is so socialized and so sociological. And so, because there's no space for us. I could send people referrals every day to go to a sex therapist. They're not going to go. But they will come and talk to me about it because in that room with your gynecologist, you have a moment of freedom. And since they're already examining your female parts and looking at your breast and looking at your vagina, talking to you about all those things, there's a sense of, I think, freedom at that moment to say, well, since you're already here, let's just talk about what's going on with my sex life. And so I've learned more about kind of where women are when it comes to sex and the very place that we are. And it's across the gamut, everything from, preteens to, patients in nursing homes to patients, everybody has ideas about it. And you really need to feel comfortable that your gynecologist is supposed to talk to you about your sex life. It's supposed to talk to you about if you your lack of libido or your desire for more than what your partner can give. That's a big one, right? A lot of women come in, they're married, and their spouse can't perform for whatever medical reason or whatever, and they want to talk about that. I mean, there's such a wide array. And just know that your gynecologist, that's what we're trained to do. We're supposed to be able to talk to you about all of those things and give you some meaningful steps to work on that and to help you to feel comfortable because if you don't have a happy sexual life, then it's difficult to have other things in your life. So, that's my pitch for gynecology, I guess.
No, but I think it's important that people know where to go for assistance. I mean, I think a lot of times we've demonstrated that for men there's such a stigma. about talking to anybody about it until the advent of Viagra and Levitra and these other things where you could just kind of get a prescription and maybe get over some of these issues. I think for women, it's a little bit different. And I just, you know, I guess I never thought about it. I thought they should talk to me, but I never thought about it. I never thought about where you would go for some professional advice in that area. 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. We have a few more minutes left. If you want to talk to Dr. Joya Crepera, she's an obstetrician and gynecologist who practices in the New Orleans area. Very impressive bio and certainly an opportunity for you to get your questions answered. Well, one of the kind of for last, this whole issue now about HPV. Explain to people what it is, what the metamorphosis of it, of its importance is, and why we're so pushing to get the immunizations for HPV.
Right. Okay. Thank you so much. So, you know, what happened about the same time that we started talking about the whole mammogram issue, that task force that, you know, wanted to decrease mammograms, also started talking about what we should do with pap smears. And so it made us stop and take a minute and think, okay, what should we be doing? All right, so HPV is called human papillomavirus. So you probably know people who have breast cancer. We talked a lot about that today. You might know people who have prostate cancer or lung cancer. Cervical cancer is the only cancer that we know of that you get from sex, from the human papillomavirus. I love telling my teenagers, not only can those dirty, nasty boys give you herpes and HIV, they can give you cancer. You got to watch them. But anyway, so HPV is a virus that you get from sex. And so we actually have a vaccine that we can give young people to keep them from getting cervical cancer. There was a time that we had a high incidence of cervical cancer in the U.S., and we really decreased it just because of one simple test. And you don't really know that people have lung cancer until they have a cancer. They don't have, you know, you don't know that people have stomach cancer, they have cancer. With the screening test, the pap smear, you can actually catch it before it becomes cancer. You can treat it so that you don't get cancer later on in life. And so the purpose of getting screenings every year, getting pap smears every year, is to keep you from getting a cancer. If only we could do that for almost everything, that would be awesome, right? Like if we could figure out a way to check for lung cancer every year, they have a pretest that when you're getting it, you can do something to keep you from getting it. But we haven't gotten there yet with lung cancer. We've gotten there with cervical cancer. It's called a pap smear, and that's why it's important that people go and get it done, especially African-American women and women of color, because we have a higher incidence in general of having them.
Yeah, so when you talk about, what are the recommendations for this HPV vaccine?
Okay, so the HPV vaccine currently, so it's changing. In the beginning, it was only for girls, and we wanted to do it from 10 to 26. And the reason is that we wanted them to be old enough. You don't have to do it when you do kind of your pre-K age immunization, you know, like when you get the polio vaccine and all those kinds of things. But you want to do it before they start having intercourse. Because, like I mentioned earlier, it's a cancer that you get from a dirty, stinky boy like Dr. Lenore. I'm just kidding.
Right.
So you want to get the vaccine before you actually have intercourse to keep you, the likelihood of you actually getting a cancer later on. So my own daughter, I didn't do it at 10, but when she was old enough to drive herself at 14, I sent her an adult. She drove herself to her pediatrician, and she got her three series of, I'm sorry, 16. She got her three series of HPV vaccine. So you really want to do it before they're sexually active so that you can, they won't get cervical cancer later on in life.
Right, and one final topic that I wanted to reach before we end our show is the whole issue of contraception, not contraception, but fertility. I mean, how far have we come in being able to adequately guarantee that couples who are, quote, infertile after a certain stage, what can we do? I mean, are we in era now where we can do a number of different things? Has that changed? Does everybody end up with five sets of twins? I mean,
So we've come a long way. We still have a long way to go, and we as a society, to decide how far we want to go. So right now, we can freeze eggs, and I have this funny story. One of my friends from college, when we were about 35, she said, you know, I'm just going to freeze my eggs, and then one day when I meet a man, I'll just unfreeze them and have a baby. So if you're going to put eggs in your 60-year-old body, is that the plan? Like, how is that going to work out? So although we have technology to do a lot of things, nothing is forever. Women in general, even with frozen eggs, we're spending a lot of money and a lot of time. You can usually have babies up till about age 44, 45, and that's actually worth a lot of effort. Our what we call the fancy doctor word for it is fecundability. Fecundability means your ability to get pregnant decreases starting around age 30 each year. So by the time you get to age 35 to 40, it's decreased significantly. And so, you know, our society says we should be older when we get pregnant because we want to make sure that we have adequate resources, you know, a husband, a house, all these other things. And so meeting those things in the middle is kind of where we are. And that's why we have to make decisions around what that means. We are getting closer to being able to put this DNA together. So right now, we can freeze the egg and get some sperm and we can make a baby. We're getting closer to saying we just need DNA. So we could have two women. We could have two eggs and make a baby. I mean, all those things are really coming. And I don't doubt that they will come within our lifetime. So the question for us will be, what is our goal? Putting a baby inside of an unhealthy uterus, no matter how old you are, if you're 19 or if you're 90, it's not a good option. If you have hypertension and diabetes and smoking and drinking and doing all those things, the baby will not have a good outcome. And so being our healthiest person is important. The older you are, the more likely you have other things like hypertension and diabetes. You know, you don't really have those at 25 in general, but you do. A lot of folks have it at 45, 50. So thinking about that when you start delaying pregnancy and what that means, we've only had, and this is the truth, and this is what they don't say. They don't have a really large study around having babies with a frozen egg or a frozen embryo in your 40s. There's no big, huge meta-analysis around it because there haven't been a lot. I mean, there are people who are spending a lot of money to freeze eggs in California and New York because they have a lot of money to do that. But there have only been a few births from those eggs. And so just know that you can spend your money to do it, but you need to ask them, now, how many actual live babies that are healthy have been born in your facility from a frozen egg? So someone who froze an egg at 30 and now they're 50 and they put this embryo inside of their body. If they can't give you a solid answer, they need to rethink spending that money.
Yeah, and one of the other things that you get big concerned about, people are really kind of designing things. I mean, they want a child that's this size and this age and this. And
right.
I mean, so a lot of that brings up a lot of ethical questions in the future. But I would like to stop and thank you, Dr. Perry. The hour went by so quickly that we didn't have enough time to spend together. There are still several questions on the air, but we'll be back. Well, we hope that you'll be willing to. I guess she took me more literally. But anyway, so the program is over for today. Next week, we'll be talking again about the Affordable Care Act, trying to see what kind of experience you've had. Our special guest will be Dr. Cornacenix, who is an expert and talks a little bit about what we are, those of you who believe that we should be having insurance coverage should need to be doing. So thank you, Dr. Perry. Thank you, others, for joining us. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
Brian Edwards Tekert, very excited to welcome to the stage Nomi Prinz. She worked for Bear Stearns. She worked for Goldman Sachs. And since she left, she has written 5 devastating books about how Wall Street really works. Her latest is All the President's Bankers, The Hidden Alliances That Drive American Power. It's a 100-year history of how a small elite has dominated finance, politics, and shaped world history. Robert Reich calls the book disturbing and important. Ralph Nader says it's a must-read. And Nomi Prinz will present it Monday, April 21st at the Hillside Club in Berkeley, 2286 Cedar Street, starting at 7:30 p.m. It's a KPFA benefit. There's wheelchair access, limited seating. You can get tickets in advance at brownpapertickets.com or supportive bookstores. That's Wall Street whistleblower Nomi Prinz on Monday, April 21st with me, Brian Edwards-Tiekert. See you there.